Yes, and we're starting.
Yes, we need to wait for Sander to join.
Already to use to share.
Okay, so you need to first explain. So you go first three slides, and then
yes.
I will probably share my desktop, and we go through the slides and discuss things, right?
Okay. Can you see my slides in this moment?
Yep.
Well, this I will try to be short. We have for today, the webinar title is ICD-6 Troubleshooting for Help Desk. We will have two experts in this topic. In a few minutes, I will say a very short bio of them. People is Jansor and Sander Stefan. Mr. Jansor, he is an expert. He has already been in several LACNIC meetings. He has worked quite a lot in different ISPs. He has a lot of experience in IPv6. He has a very nice CV, but one of the biggest things and most famous things that he has worked with is to write documents. Basically, I want to mention the RITE 5501. It already was updated by RITE 554. But it is a very nice document that talks about what the devices has to accomplish to be IPv6 ready. That document is quite nice. I recommend all of you. And second, I want to introduce Sander Stefan. Sander Stefan is an ICT specialist, graduated in computer science at the University of Twente. And well, he has also worked a lot in ISPs. He has a lot of experience in Internet Service Providers Network. And one of the things that he does, he's the co-chair of the RIPE Address Policy Working Group. And today, Sander and Jan, they are together because they are the experts who are going to talk to us about the help desk and IPv6. And as a reminder, now we have had many webinars in LACNIC. Please remember that all of them can be found in the LACNIC channel in YouTube. There is the link. And before we continue, in case you have a special or a particular topic that you would like us to deal with, to have a discussion, to create a webinar, please let us know to LACNIC, to me. We will try to do our best to fit your needs. We really want to listen and to hear what the people want to listen to. So please, in case you have a topic and you would like us, LACNIC, to reach experts, we can try to do it. And finally, and this is the very final, please remember this session is being recorded. If everything goes okay, and I believe it will, we will put it in the YouTube channel. And that's all from me so far. So feel free to continue, Jan. And thank you so much for joining us in this call.
Okay, thank you very much. But first of all, I need some help desk support here because my application is all in Spanish. And how do I share my presentation?
Okay, well, in Spanish, the word share is compartir.
Okay.
C-O-M-P-A-R-T-I-R.
Compartir. Yes. And then?
What I will do too is to put you as a presenter.
Okay. And then I can go application and go Microsoft PowerPoint, right?
Exactly. That's all.
Let me see what happens.
Amazing technology.
Okay. It's amazing technology. So does everybody see Can everybody see my presentation?
Looks good from here.
Yes, it looks fine.
Fine? Okay, so hello everybody. This will be a joint presentation from myself and Sander. I'm glad that we were invited to talk about this stuff. Alejandro, I would like to correct you a little bit. I'm not the only co-author of RIPE 501 and RIPE 554. Sander is also the co-author of this document. So we have both been working on both these documents that will be mentioned a lot today. But I never expected so much people registered, and thank you for joining us. I hope we will have a good next hour talking about IPv6 troubleshooting for help desks using the isp.test.ipv6.com document. So if there are any questions, probably you can chime in, or you can post them over the chat. I believe Alejandro will follow the chat, because I have full screen here of this PowerPoint, so I cannot see the chat and maybe interrupt. But we will try to talk through with Sander about what were the incentives for this document, how you can use it, and how it's being used around the world, right? So, okay. I will try to go forward. First, two things about me. Alejandro already introduced me. I'm founder of Slovenian Go6 Institute. I worked in internet operations for 20 plus years. I have 16 plus years of IPv6 experience, and I'm quite active member of RIPE and IETF communities. I've been working on this RIPE documents a lot, especially the usual ones that are mostly operational and deployment oriented for IPv6. And I joined the Internet Society Do team in December 2012, where I'm still working as a full staff member and working on IPv6 DNSSEC, routing security, TLS, and all these exciting technologies that are emerging. And I will leave to Sander to introduce himself. Please, Sander.
Hi, I am Sander Stefan. I'm an independent IPv6 consultant, have been for a couple of years now, and I do many different projects ranging from strategy at a bank to actually configuring and debugging routers, running stuff in test labs. I'm involved in the Netherlands IPv6 Foundation. I'm one of the founding members there. I'm one of the current co-chairs of the RIPE Address Policy Working Group, which basically is the working group that sets the policy for Europe, the Middle East, and a part of Asia. I'm involved in the Netherlands IPv6 Task Force, and like Jan said, we work together on many different documents. Documents, working on documentation for enterprises. I'm doing trainings in the Middle East. RIPE NCC asked me to give V6 trainings in Saudi Arabia in May. So I travel to many places, do a lot of IPv6 related stuff, and yeah, I'm really happy that you invited me here to co-present this with Jan.
Yeah, we are the globetrotters, so all around the world. Trying to do some good stuff on the internet, but okay, let's go forward. Let's make this okay. First, the words of text warning. I would like to apologize. There is a lot of text in these slides. I know there are. It's not very good if you have lots of text in your slides. It's not modern. But since we are here talking about the document and there is lots of content in this stuff. Despite the long contemplation, I did not find a way how to do this in any other way, but we apologize for any inconvenience. Please bear with us anyway. And I would also like to set away some misconceptions. I heard a lot of people saying, oh, this is ISOC document. It's not an ISOC document. This is a product of a group of brilliant experts from the community. and Sander will also can tell you a bit more about how we started, how we collected this great group of people together, and worked on a document. I just happened to be the initiator and one of the editors, as Sander. But I would like to thank ISOC for dedicating some of my working time to run these efforts. And this is about it. So, Sander, can you please explain why we did this? Because we removed one of the first speed bumps with Write 554. Can you say a few words about Write 554?
Yeah, it was really interesting. It was one of the earlier meetings where Jan and I were talking, and there was a discussion from people saying, okay, we want to make sure that what we buy is actually IPv6 compatible, but we don't know what to ask for, because in reality, we've seen products where people would say, oh, it's V6 compatible, and then it turned out you could ping it over V6, and that was it. So that didn't really mean anything. So people were looking at, what do we need? So I was talking to Jan, and Jan showed me a document in Slovenian going like, okay, this is what I wrote for our government. Do you think it would be useful? So it turned out to be a complete specification of everything you needed to ask for when buying ICT equipment. So we started by throwing it into Google Translate and then doing a lot of fixing up and fixing the language. And that basically became RIPE 501, the first document. But we realized that this was a starting point, so at that point we involved the rest of the community, and we got lots of input from lots of different people. Marek Akeo joined us as one of the co-authors, and together we tried to put as much stuff we could into the document as possible. We included stuff about CPEs, what you need to look for. We talked about software, contractual requirements, all those kinds of things. And then with the RIPE community, the IPv6 working group, we worked together with a lot of people. And the end result of that is RIPE 554. So this is a document that is really widely supported. It took a couple of months of discussion on the mailing list to exactly decide which bits are important, which bits are less important, and to find a really good balance between wanting to push the right technology forward, but on the other hand, also write something that was usable in real life. So you can ask for a lot of interesting things, but if nobody will sell it to you, then that's pretty pointless. And at some point, I remember Jan talking to somebody from Cisco, asking Cisco what their roadmap was, and basically Cisco told us, like, why do you ask us? You wrote the roadmap. So this has been like driving the whole development of IPv6, what people ask for, and what vendors actually will deliver. So this was one of the big problems in V6, and that's how we solved it. And then we started looking for what the next big problem was. And of course, at that time, and we're talking a couple of years ago, a lot of internet providers just didn't offer IPv6. And one of the big reasons there was that they said, well, we don't know how to support it. We're afraid that if we start doing V6, customers will start calling us, and this will increase help desk costs and cause big problems for us.
Yeah.
So at that point, we realized that this was a big problem for IPv6 worldwide, and Jan kicked it off and drew together a group of people to go and fix this.
Yeah, actually, there was lots of operators told me the same story all around the world. It doesn't matter on which continent you were. They lots of them said, look, we implemented IPv6 in our core. We implemented in our services. We did the test trials with our users, but now we are not enabling it because we have a feeling that our help desk will just burn down in flame if we do it. So it was time to remove the next IPv6. Speed bump. So we all know people at the help desks, right? We all called them. We probably, many of us even worked at one when we began our career. I remember when we started our national ISP, what sort of calls we got to the help desk, and then you develop this special attitude, being at the help desk and trying to get people off the phone as quickly as possible, because there is other people in the line waiting. So help desk can be, they can be difficult sometimes, especially if you ask them the question that they don't understand or they have no experience with. So that was also another reason why we thought of documenting the IPv6 troubleshooting procedures might be a really good idea. So it's not just about have you tried it turning off and on again, but it's more like you need, you know, if people have issues with the internet access, you need to probably fix them. And this is how it all started. Here on this slide, you can see the contributors and others, and you can see there are some big names in there and big companies. It's Lee Howard, Time Warner Cable, is John Jason Brzozowski from Comcast. So currently, John Jason Brzozowski, I just spoke with him. He deployed IPv6 at the whole network. He has millions and millions of IPv6 users in Comcast network. He's now trying to put IPv6 only for the management network and manage CPEs on IPv6 only. And his near-term project is going IPv6 only also in the whole network and implement IPv4 as a service to lower the cost. So Sander, how many users does he have now? Do you remember the number he said in Paris?
I don't remember the exact number, but I know that they manage the cable modems with IPv6 space. Because the 10/8 space was too small to contain all their cable modems, so it's at least more than 16 million.
Yeah, I think they have 38 million users or something like this, and crazy numbers. And he just deployed IPv6 and nothing spectacular happened. He's also one of the authors. We have also Jason Fessler, so we were quite lucky to get Jason Fessler from Yahoo in the group, because he's actually the one who built and developed the testipv6.com web application, web portal that tests your connectivity. We will talk about this later. And there are also some other people, there is David Friedman, Tim Chown, Sander, it's you, Chris Randeman, he now left ISOC, there's Jen Linkova from Google, Chris Taskak from Comcast, Daniel Brewer, and myself. So this was a group of people. We also met once in real life at the IETF in Berlin, and that we said, okay, let's meet for an hour and discuss the document. And that turned into 6 or 7 hours meeting and carving the documents and things like this. Would you like to add something, Sander?
Well, I think I actually missed the Berlin meeting, but yeah, every time some of these people on the list met, even like Jan and I met, or Jen was there, or you know, small subsets. Every time we came together, there was something in our mind going like, oh, we can fix this or we can improve that. So this is something that, the enthusiasm of all those people working together was really what made it happen.
Yeah, and we just occupied one big table in the bar, in the lobby, and we started working, right? And good things came out. All right. So what is this? What were the questions that we asked ourselves? Okay, fact number one. So we need to build a short and simple set of detect, explain, action scenarios that would help people and help desk identify and fix the issue. So when a person calls in and says, "Look, I have an issue. I have a problem with my internet connectivity," what do you do? You need to, if you start asking a person questions, then usually they go, yeah, my internet doesn't work. and this is not very, very useful. So we needed to build a simple set of tools that would help people at the help desks.
I think the really important bit there is an ISP has lots of tools internally. They can look from their point of view, but you really need to understand what the customer is seeing. So you need a tool that actually tests from the customer's connection and not from the core network. And this is this is the really crucial bit. You need to understand what the customer is seeing without having to tell the customer to install crazy pieces of software on his computer.
Yeah, crazy piece of software is just the web browser, basically. And it's also good if you can if you can point your users to your local mirror. So whoever wants a local mirror, testipvc.com, by the way, it's open and free, and everybody is more than happy that the new mirrors around the world are being built. I established one in my Go6 lab, and it's working fine and helping other people to troubleshoot issues. So if you have your own copy of testv6.com tool, then you can point your customers to it. But if you want also to test the external connectivity down to your customers, then you can point them to some other tool. So yeah, you have options. What do you want to measure? And if you don't detect a problem with your local copy, point them to the outer one. So yeah, the fact number two was that we need a simple online tool to detect the state of connectivity on the user's computer. And fact number three is that testipv6.com is a very useful tool that detects the states of connectivity, and it works. But it's a little bit too complicated for the end users. This is good for IPv6 enthusiasts that would like to understand all the complex underlying stuff. But you know, the meaning is there. So the thing that could do the basics was there. It just needed. I see Hugo saying that you're cool. You just installed the testipv6.com mirror. Brilliant. Thank you. So the idea emerged to bring Jason Pessler. He is a great guy from Yahoo. So I tried to convince him with beer, but it did not work. Then I discovered that he's drinking rum and cola. So that was his weak point. And I managed to get him to get him in and actually build a special version of the tool that is called isp.test-v6.com. And that was the start of the win. So I think I tested this in Serbia somewhere at some conference. I think it's a Southeastern Europe RIPE regional meeting or something. So this is how it looks like. At the top you have the URL that everybody can use. It's all around the world. It's open and free. Just use it. And here you can see how well was the tool basically modified and simplified. So when the user calls you, you just tell him, okay, go to this website, please, and then can you tell me the help desk code that is written in blue? And help desk code might tell you a lot of things about the user's connectivity, and the help desk codes are actually described in our document, as you will see later. So for those who need more data, there is also other data. It's like which AS is and what's happening with IPv4, with IPv6, what are the addresses and so on. But the most important one is about help desk code.
Yeah, one of the problems we foresaw when we started this was asking the customer, when you use the normal test IPv6, it gives you a score like 8 out of 10. And then you have to ask the customer for lots of details. and we want mm-hmm. something that with one question you get like the core of the problem, and that is that help desk code. So it's so much faster. The even a customer who doesn't know anything about IPv6, they don't need to understand technical language. They just need to tell you a number.
Yep. All right. Would you like to go to the table of contents?
Let's skip to the next slide. We'll basically what we're going to do is show you the flow of the document, this flow of the procedure of how to use it, and actually a list of all the codes that might show up.
Yeah. So the useful stuff starts in a fifth chapter, basically. There is where the IPv6 troubleshooting flowchart starts, and then you have the explanation of help desk codes. And you see that we have got quite a few of them. There is the continuation of the table of contents. And then you also have the additional hints. It's like slow. If the connection is really slow, it's the MTU. So if you get the MTU addition, that means possible MTU issues warning, that if there is a first level help desk on the other side of the phone, they should hand it over to more experienced network admins, because the help desk guys should probably are not able to fix the MTU issues. And then we also have sites with the failed connectivity. There is also an interesting warning that can tell you that if you have sites with the failed connectivity, that means if you have like 48 out of 52 successful and four of them are not successful, that can mean that maybe that four sites are down, because that tool just fetches a very small JPEG file out of that site, but maybe you have problems in your routing, in your BGP routing and announcements to these four sites. So, if you have sites with failed connectivity, it's worth exploring why these sites failed. Then we also have something that we will not mention later. It's IPv6 training for help desks. So as you can see, the structure of the document is like you can probably print it out and add the operator specific in a ninth chapter and hand it over to your help desk saying, look, this is what you need to know about IPv6 that we are deploying, check mark, and then continue with your deployment of IPv6, because in chapter 7 there is also some advice to the help desk manager, how to do the training for the help desk people, what is needed, and what are these stuff that people need to know.
Yeah, as example, I actually used this document at one of the ISPs in my own country here,
mm-hmm.
Some of the things in the some of the result codes are not even relevant to them. Like, for example, they don't do NAT64 on their network. In that case, I just shortened the document. I was like, mm-hmm. So these are the cases that are relevant to our network. Those you can run into. This is how you need to deal with them. If you see one of these result codes, escalate, because this should never happen on our network. If a customer sees this this code, something is really wrong. They have weird tunnels set up or other things.
Mm-hmm.
So you can even shorten the document to pick out the bits that are interesting for you. I mean, it's a template. You can use it in any way you want that makes sense for your help desk.
Yep. Okay. Let's go further. So this is the first example, and this is a copy paste from the document. One of the possible generic situations is you can go to help desk code 624, and that's actually means that it's 624, and basically what the document says is interpretation and action. So the good point is that it's very clearly and concisely and simply say why this is happening, in a very simple language. And then in very concise way, it says, okay, here is what you need to do to fix this problem. So interpretation for 6 to 4 is that it was used to provide an IPv6 address and so on and so forth. And then you go like, okay, have user disabled any automatic tunneling mechanisms that are active? And here are the links how you fix it. Or, for example, continue. If IPv6 is desired, configure IPv6 and verify that the user has an IPv6 address and a default route and test again. And for example, if you follow this stuff, you can probably fix the user's bad experience with your connection. And this one is the hardest and the longest one. And this one is really, really hard to troubleshoot. This is really hard to troubleshoot. This is, if you get 112, and there are reasons why we picked this number. It's 112, right? Help. Yeah. Win.
Wow. I'm not sure if that actually applies to their continent. I know in Europe 112 is the national emergency number, like 911 in the US. So I'm not sure if 112 is relevant in your continent, but that's why we chose it.
Yeah. So here, if you have IPv4 plus broken IPv6, the issue is that you can probably have any possible cause why things are not working. This means that you have IPv6 address on your computer that is a global address, or a global address that should not be used, or something like this, and the connectivity is broken somewhere, or is your CPE, or you don't have a route, or your external connectivity is not working, or the ISP routing system is not working. There can be multiple possible issues on the path how to troubleshoot this one down.
And this one these days luckily occurs less and less because of the Happy Eyeballs implementation. Even if V6 is broken, your browser should at least get you back to V4. So V6 actually causing breakage is luckily not happening as much as it used to. But this is a really, it's a serious situation. Something is wrong. And I've seen customers that, you know, in the days before IPv6 became widespread, they were just playing with their internet settings and with the V6 settings, and then left them in a broken state because at that point it didn't cause problems for them.
And you know, when you say that, I'm thinking that actually Happy Eyeballs was good for encouraging people to implement IPv6 because they said, you know, oh, yeah, if IPv6 is not working, then it will fall over to IPv4 and nobody will notice. But then we need to fix problems, right? If you master the problems, then, you know, it will never come to this. So maybe you should send all your users that you gave them IPv6 to test here and there, just precautions that IPv6 is working.
But I think you're right. We Happy Eyeballs was necessary 5 years ago to get IPv6 deployed into the world. I think maybe in a couple of years we reached a point where Happy Eyeballs is going to cause more problems and hide the problems instead of getting them fixed. So I think Happy Eyeballs is a temporary thing that we need to get rid of at some point.
You know what does it mean, temporary, right? The word temporary.
In IT or in general?
In IT, it means that you will never get rid of. It's a completely permanent, right? So whatever is temporary, you know, we built A+P and MAP and all these sharing mechanisms that we said, oh, it's temporary. It's not, it's permanent. Also, the guy who invented NAT, Network Address Translation, said, oh, it's just permanent. Well, it's just temporary. It's not. It's really permanent. So, you know, we'll probably never get rid of that. But anyway, so here we have the interpretation, what's going on, and here is like IPv6 network connectivity is broken, what I explained before, and then it's assumption that user has already power cycled the home router. So you usually stick in this troubleshooting procedures for IPv6 inside your existing troubleshooting procedures for your help desk that you already have, right? And usually the procedure is that people power cycle the home router, the modem device as part of the standard troubleshooting procedure. I think there was a question for Sander to elaborate on something. Alejandro, can you repeat the question? Ah, okay.
Yes.
Okay.
I will.
I've seen it. Yeah,
well,
so,
go ahead, Stefan. The question, I believe, is pretty clear, but in case you need me to add something, just let me know.
Yeah, okay. Now, the Happy Eyeballs is very good for the end user because they don't notice any problems with V6. They quickly fail over back to V4. But it also means that in the long run, you are not fixing the problem, you're hiding the problem. And there are many cases, especially as a network engineer, when something goes wrong, I want to be able to test it. And now if I am testing my website to see if it works, if it fails back to IPv4 very quickly, as a network engineer, I have trouble testing this. So if I now want to test if everything works, I actually have to go to my network configuration and disable IPv4 to make sure that it can't switch back to V4 if there's a problem. So for testing and for like deterministic behavior, it actually makes it harder. I was today at a bank, and they see this as a problem because their users will usually use V6 if they have V6 because V6 is preferred. But like you have one packet dropped and the browser might switch back to V4 for one or two requests. And this is really messing with their statistics and with their also security analysis tools. So it is good that the user is pushed back to V4 very quickly because the user then doesn't notice it. But debugging and analysis and all those things become harder because the behavior of the browser becomes non-deterministic.
Yeah, especially because in the RFC, in the specification, it says that you should, and it's RFC 2119, should give the IPv6 300 milliseconds of the head start because the both protocols start basically together, and it should be sort of like, you know, 300 milliseconds of head start for IPv6, and then which protocol gets the data back wins and is used. But some implementations did not give this 300 milliseconds head start to IPv6, and things started to go really wrong.
Yeah. Now, I'll explain a bit more on the non-deterministic bit that I said. What I really like is like, if the server has V6 and the client has V6, you always use V6. If that's the default, then it's really easy to predict what will happen in situations. But with Happy Eyeballs, it's like when both the user and the server have V6, it will use V6, except in this case and maybe not in that case, and you get so many exceptions that it gets confusing to debug. I don't like exceptions. I like predictable things.
Yeah, it becomes pretty complex quite quickly. All right. So if you have this thing here, then Happy Eyeballs is not very very helpful to easier troubleshooting. But it's here. It helped us deploy V6 to the point where we are now, and we need to cope with it. You know. Not all things in life are easy and not complex, so we need to figure it out. So for whoever needs something like this for their help desk, the document is now an official RightBCOP document, is Right634. It was done in the RIPE Best Current Operational Practices Task Force and subsequently to the RIPE IPv6 Working Group in cooperation together. And What can I say further? This is the document. Go and read it, download it. It's yours. It's public. And actually, we came through the presentation quite quickly. So I would like to open sort of like a discussion. What would you like to ask, to know? Let's create some discussion around this. I'm wondering who here at this webinar actually deployed IPv6 and is looking into how to make their help desk aware of what's going on and needs something like this. Nobody?
So,
Jan, I'm receiving a private question, but please give me some seconds until the question is fully reading in the box.
Okay, not a problem. Let me see how I can.
I do have a question in the meantime.
Tell me.
I have heard many times that MPU is one of the most common problems in IPv6. How much true is that?
So the MTU is okay. Sander, can you please respond to this one? Meantime, I'm searching for something here.
Sure. The MTU in itself is not the problem. The biggest problem is actually people who don't know how to deal with ICMP error messages. In IPv4, it was really common that people just said, oh, ICMP is not really important, so I just drop all ICMP error messages. If you do that in IPv6, you get the MTU problem, because to get the right MTU size, IPv6 needs to get those error messages to understand what the MTU is. And people who drop drop the ICMP errors, they don't even realize that something is wrong. Their system sends out a packet with 1500 bytes. Some other router sends them back an error message telling them, like, oh, stop, you're sending a packet that's too big. But if they then drop the error message, they never hear about it, and their connection breaks. And I think a lot of this problem is caused by the misunderstanding of people of how important ICMP is. That's also always a big part of the education that I'm doing when I'm giving training, especially at enterprises these days, because enterprises have this default mindset that ICMP is dangerous and they need to drop it. And we need to get that out of people's heads and teach them how to deal with this, because in IPv6, ICMP contains so many bits: neighbor discovery, router advertisements, multicast listener discovery, packet to big error messages. All those things are a core part of the IPv6 protocol. And I think it's just people need to learn how to deal with them. In the past, there were also some problems with implementations where a router just wouldn't send out an ICMP error message, even when it should. I think we passed that point. I think those implementations are pretty okay these days. I think it's the education part where we need to put some effort, because we can fix this. And these days, the MTU problems aren't as big as they used to be, but they do still exist, unfortunately.
Yes, in IPv4, the ICMP message was performing four or five network controlling things. In IPv6, I think it's 54 or something. The functions but I think the most important are first 30 ones, and one of them is path MTU discovery. That's is getting better and better. I would not say it works 100%, but there are still people that blocks ICMP on the path, but hopefully with the deployment they will, and the gained knowledge about what not to do, they will stop blocking this. What we are currently getting as a potential next problem is the extension headers in IPv6 packets, because lots of people is starting to block the extension headers because they go like, oh, I don't need to extension headers, I'm not sending out anything that should use extension headers. So therefore, if there is a packet coming to my network with extension header, it must be bad, therefore I will block it. Don't do that. Okay. I see that there is some
I should take that one because that's something that I've been working on.
Okay.
In the last year.
Yeah.
So yeah, if you're an ISP and you're deploying IPv6, usually what you do is DHCP from the ISP to the customer to give the customer a block of addresses, a prefix. Usually a /48 or maybe a /56. And then the customer CPE will use, like you said, Slack or DHCP to give stuff to the user at home. If you look at that part of DHCP, that is a part that I'm usually less happy with. The DHCP part from the ISP to the CPE is really important. That's prefix delegation. That's just the way it works. And I've rolled that out at a big ISP in the Netherlands. It's fine. But DHCP in the home network, especially for consumer networks, is often too much. It's often overkill. You don't need it. DHCP is interesting maybe for an enterprise that wants to keep tight control over the addressing. But usually Slack is a much, much better choice for a home network. The only thing where I do use DHCP for is for stateless DHCP, so to tell the client about the DNS server and things like that. But it's controversial. Android is even the guy who makes the decisions for Android for V6 is so much against DHCP that he said Android will never ever support DHCP V6. So I think for home networks you really need to go with Slack.
So can you tell people how frustrated you need to be to write your own DHCP V6 server?
Well, the problem I had was that I was working at the ISP and I was doing DHCP, like I said, from the ISP to the CPE to do prefix delegation. And one of the things I ran into was that the ISC DHCP server, when you did something with the configuration to do static assignments to customers, it would just crash. It would just stop. These days, ISC has published Kia, the new DHCP server. That one is much better. It's a really nice piece of software. But when I was working on this, I just became so frustrated that I just couldn't find a DHCP server that could do simple static assignments to my customers. So in that case, like you said, I became so frustrated, I just started writing my own DHCP server in Python for custom cases, like integrating with ISP management tools. And that has actually been running for quite a while. I'm actually getting money from SIDN, the .nl domain registry, to sponsor its development because they think it's also an important piece of software. But yeah, you know, you run into a speed bump and you fix it.
Well, of course. Well, I need to set up your DHCP V6 server in my lab to see how it works. You know,
hey, you need to try to break it.
I will. Don't worry. So okay, we have another question here. The accept 112 code. What is the worst scenario? To me personally, the worst scenario is MTO issues when the first level help desk gets from the user, oh, it says also MTO issues, then you know that things are going really, really wrong on your network. That's where, but the important point where we wanted to put a very, very fine line and very defined point is where to escalate, when to escalate, at which point in time or into the problem your help desk needs to escalate to more experienced network admins and ask them to look into the problem. And this is also why we did this basic troubleshooting flowchart. Lusandra, do you see this flowchart on the screen?
Yes,
am I sharing the right thing? Okay.
You are.
So here are things when it says when to escalate, and in the next chapter you have some sort of the advice for the help desk, what information to collect from the user, so the and to put it into the escalation ticket, so the more experienced guys on the other side would be it's easier for them to fix the problems. But if you go to this website, you can download the PDF and you will have it all. Sander, what would be your worst scenario?
One that I actually ran into was somebody whose CPE had 6-4 enabled, but the 6-4 relay that was getting the packets was just dropping everything. So then you just get a big black hole where all your packets just disappear, and that goes over a tunnel to somewhere on the internet. So that was impossible to debug.
Oh dear! How complex can the troubleshooting be, huh?
We had a lot of interesting protocols like 6-4 and Teredo and all those things to get IPv6 started. But I think we reached a point where we also need to clean up all the testing stuff and from the early days.
Yep. Oh, I see we have another from Jorge Gonzalez. And I don't know if I'm spelling this correctly, but in your experience, what are some security problems that IPv6 at user level deployment cause for network admins, DHCP, SLARC, etc? Thanks.
I immediately know the answer to this one, and it's actually the biggest problem for people who don't do IPv6. I'll tell it by using an example from Eric Vinke, a great guy from Cisco, does a lot of security stuff and analysis stuff. He always, when he's at an airport, he logs into the guest Wi-Fi at the airport and then sends out router advertisements from his laptop to the Wi-Fi. And then tries to measure how many clients actually try to use his laptop as a default gateway. I think he once reached a couple of hundred. So that's the biggest problem. If you have a network and nobody pays attention to V6, one person sending out router advertisements onto that network will mess everything up. So the solution is actually to start working on V6 to prevent this.
So the biggest security issue is ignorance, basically.
Definitely.
Yep, I agree. Because that I saw many companies and even enterprises. So there is a story. It was one of my friends. He's actually the Microsoft MVP. It's sort of like I don't know the Microsoft scales, but that is like quite a high level guy at Microsoft, and he was trying to debug the issues when he had two Windows servers and they were sending files. There were some shares, or I don't know how they are called there, and the file did not come over correctly. So he tried to troubleshoot and he put a Wireshark there and he sees no traffic at all. It's like, what's going on? I see no traffic. And then he clicked the checkbox with IPv6, and then all of a sudden he saw that all the traffic is going over IPv6, and it was like, whoa, dude, seriously? because he did not even know that his machines were predominantly using IPv6, and he had no security plan for IPv6. He had no firewall. He had nothing in place for IPv6. IPv6 just happened to him without even knowing, and he was not prepared for it. He had no idea what to do with it, but it was just there. It was working. Then there were issues when the documents started leaking, the classified documents started leaking out of the company, because somebody installed HE tunnel, the tunnel broker stuff on his laptop at home, and connected to Hurricane Electric IPv6 tunnel broker. And he just followed the instructions there, and he started sending array packets at home and his home network, and everything was working fine. And everybody was happy. But then in the morning, this guy just took his laptop and took it to the bank and connected to the bank internal network. And all of a sudden, their firewalls did not understand what is protocol 41. That is actually this little tunnel over IPv4 for getting IPv6. He connected and he started sending array packets around, and all the machines in the internal network started getting IPv6. And then because he had no firewall on his machine, he became a gateway. These people started communicating through his machine. And then some people started looking back, who is these people that are now communicating over IPv6? And basically he created a back channel for other people to start coming back through this channel into the highly secured environment without any firewall, without anything. So, you know, not understanding IPv6 and not knowing IPv6 and not getting it under control in your network, that's a real risk. There are technical security issues, but the biggest risk is actually ignorance.
I think I heard somebody put it once who said, if you're a network admin and you're not managing IPv6, you're not really the network admin anymore.
Yeah,
somebody else will probably be taking over from you without you knowing it.
Network is administering you.
It's a big risk. I think the best way to deal with IPv6 is actually have a plan and work on it and make sure that you understand what the risks are.
Yeah, I got a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, what about the fact that IPv6 is under global domain for all customers under a home network, like all computers? May that not be a main issue, you know, from all the computers with spam problems and stuff?
Well, you know, IPv6 space is vastly larger than IPv4, right? And spam, you know, anti-spam mechanisms were basically a quick and dirty hack in IPv4, because you started to value the validity of IPv4 and trustfulness of IP address. Here, we will probably have to figure out something else. And there is one very good, if you're afraid of spam and things like this, there is one very good advice from Frank Martin from LinkedIn. There is a document, how to run email server on IPv6. And you need to use the combination of SPF, DKIM, and DMARC. With the combination of these three verification sort of mechanisms, you can very much limit the amount of spam that you are getting. But still, you give every user, if you give every user /48, you know, that is vast amount of space. So I think that first hop security mechanisms are still a bit in development, but currently, so on one hand is sort of like worrying from experts that understand the security risk. But on the other hand, there is a proven millions of home users that are already using IPv6. And the sky did not fall, and nobody died, and things are working. People are not even noticing it. And currently, and I'm knocking on the wood here, there were no big security incidents that you could appoint just because people was using IPv6. And majority of it was, so the good thing that I hear from the operators that actually deployed IPv6 is, don't tell your users you are putting up a new protocol. Just don't. If you do your work correctly, then you will deploy IPv6. You will give IPv6 to your end users. Their CPEs will do everything that is needed to provision it on the inside of the user's network, and people will just get IPv6 and start using it. They should not even notice, because there is a nice psychology to this. Whoever informed their users that they said, okay, now we have a new protocol, then users started calling in and starting to complain, saying, oh, this is not working. It must be because of this new thing. This doesn't scale. This doesn't work. If user calls in that their user experience is bad, then you need to fix problems. But if you tell people that you are deploying a new protocol, you will just cause more problems and people trying to figure out what it is. Just let them use it. It's just another protocol, right?
Yeah, and I think the good comparison is if how many customers do actually call your sales department and ask for IPv4? And how many customers just call your sales department and say, I want the internet because I want to go to Facebook? Yep. Users don't care how it's delivered. They just want access to the internet. And as an ISP, it's your job to make sure that you deliver a good connection, no matter what protocol it is.
Mm-hmm. Of course. That takes me to another issue. It may be we're trying to deploy IPv6 to our customers. Me as a first customer, so you're for testing purposes. So right now, I think the main issue we're having is the NAT64, DNX64. I'm trying to deploy one on the office's side, but I haven't got it done. So we're getting a DNS64 all the way to Ukraine or I don't know where, and back. So
Slovenia would be my guess.
Yeah.
Because you're looking at the guy who runs the NAT64 box in Slovenia. So.
Are you using the GoSix Lab deployment of NAT64?
Yeah, I'm using. XDS is editing the packages. The name of the website. XDS, they don't load you a Fedora server for you to deploy, but I couldn't get it working, so we use the own NAT64, DNX64.
It's actually quite easy to set up for testing, but if you go to go6lab.si, I can send you the link. I'm running three implementations of NAT64 that you can publicly test and send packets. But then, yes, you will send packets from wherever you live to Slovenia, and then it will be translated here. And actually, this site was used by Google to fine-tune and debug their 464 exit implementation in Android. I got an email from Lorenzo saying, Jan, thank you for running it. They figured out some bugs because three of them were not behaving exactly the same. So they were able to. So if you just need it for testing the functionality, not the performance, then this is good enough. But otherwise, if you have a Cisco box somewhere, I have several of them lying around in my lab, and I'm running one implementation of NAT64 is on ASR1K. And it's running pretty nicely. It's all of it is probably four lines of configuration file. It's super easy to set it up.
Okay, I already got a link here. Thank you very much for your answer.
Yeah, so this link here for Go6 Lab is how you set it up to test my boxes in my lab. I'm not sure that the ACDC one is currently working. That has some problems, but I think that if you go to the Palo Alto one, because I'm running the big Palo Alto Networks firewall 4050 that has NAT6 work capability, that one should work, and also the Cisco one, the ASR1K, because they just run the whole Cisco Live with, I don't know, 10,000 people there. They were connecting to my lab, and things were melting down, but it survived.
Okay. Thank you. Got it now. Well, something else I just came up my mind. When you use a Slack OT configuration, how do you deliver the DNS server?
With Slack?
Yeah.
Oh, now you're opening the can of worms. Now you're opening the can of worms. So there is the RFC that says that you can put the RDNS option in the RA packet. So, for example, if you're using the MikroTik, or I don't know how you call it, MikroTik,
yeah,
routers, then you have a very clean and nice way of putting this in. Do you know how to do that in MikroTik?
On MikroTik, what I do, I set up my gateway IP on the interface bridge or whatever I'm going to to use my computer, and it does auto negotiation, you know, network advertisement, router station, and now I just gotta put my DNS.
If you set /IP DNS, if you set the system DNS of the router itself, and you put IPv6 address in there as a DNS server for the router itself, and then when you go to the router advertisement to the ND, when you say advertise on all interfaces, you say advertise DNS. There is a checkbox, advertise DNS, and when you do that, you probably need to reboot the MikroTik because it is just the way it is. And then you will see if you start capturing the array packets with Wireshark and start digging down, you will also see the array option, and you will see RDNS option and the DNS inside. I know because I'm using that. I have a lot of MikroTik routers in my lab, also the CloudCore routers, and I'm using this actually for my home segments that I have from my lab here. I'm using MikroTik to advertise the RDNS. And basically, I'm in my home environment. I'm not running DHCP v6 because I just don't need it. Because the MacBook and every other device at my home understands the RDNS in router advertisement packet. Okay, that tells you that I'm not running Windows at home, but you know.
Now, that's the question of DHCP versus the RDNSS option. Basically, there are two different ways of telling a client what the DNS resolver is. Windows does not support the RDNSS option in the RA, so you need at least a stateless DHCP server. Android doesn't support the stateless DHCP server and needs the option in the RA. So, as a network administrator, the only real option you have is to provide both of them on your network so everybody can get it. Like I said, stateless DHCP. Don't do address assignments over DHCP. Just do it for the DNS. And, yeah, then you can support everybody, and it just works.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you for your answer. I've been stuck there for months. This book and this one.
Come to a LACNIC meeting, and you will not need books anymore.
Thank you very much.
Not a problem. Okay, so Alejandro is saying that we have time for one more question. Are there any more questions? Oh, Matthias. Hi, Matthias.
Hi.
All right. Okay, Matthias, talk. We cannot hear you. You need a microphone.
Yeah?
Now we can hear you, yes.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Thank you for sharing your time. It's late where you are, so thank you for that. To you and to your parents, too.
I already had my yerba mate cup today, so I'm good.
Okay. Will we take you from yerba to Cuba if you...
I'm not coming to Cuba. I'm sorry. Maybe next one. Yeah.
Okay. The question. We have the problem of language here. Our troubleshooting team or our support team that doesn't know to speak English, less than me at least. And there are any translation project or something to translate the document?
Now I will be very political. That's a great question, and thank you for asking it. No, sorry. You know that this RIPE 501 and RIPE 55, basically RIPE 554 document, is the translation project is going on, right? It's being now translated into Spanish and also Portuguese. As far as I know, I don't know if Ariel is here, he was leading this project, and I think that if you have a group of experts that already know how to talk and work together with translating the RIPE IPv6 documents that Sander and I did, then when RIPE 554 is done, then I suggest that the same group starts with this one, with the troubleshooting guide. What do you think?
Okay. I work with Ariel. Now he must leave, and he sent you greetings. And okay, well, I will talk with him. Maybe I'm not up to date with all the projects he has. So.
Yeah,
I will talk with him.
I think it would be great because you know this is useful all around the world. The help desks are not that different around the world, and you know RIPE 554 was translated in more than 10 languages. Now we're getting also a Spanish version.
Okay.
And continuing this effort would be great.
Okay. Thank you.
On that note, if any of you actually has something and you're like, okay, we are now, you know, we know how to buy equipment, we know how to do help desks. If you have any other things where you think this is going to be the next speed bump, please participate in LACNIC, in RIPE, in the stuff that ISOC is doing. I think one of the major points at the moment is about enterprises, because enterprises still need a lot of help. I'm working on that at the moment. But if you have anything where you think this is something that is blocking IPv6, please let us know, because we're constantly looking for those speed bumps to fix them.
Yeah, we are constantly looking, you know. We can make up by ourselves the problems that need to be solved, but you know we are both dealing with IPv6 for like 16 years, and you know we would like to hear from the community what the actual speed bumps are, what you guys are struggling with, and how to help. So we are really here to help, because we would just like to make internet a bit better place. That's all.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Okay.
Well, Jan, Stefan, wanted to say first that this is our first webinar in English. So thank you so much for being with us. And hopefully this will not be the last. For us, it's very important to have webinar in English because we also attend English spoken countries. And one more time, I wanted to say thank you to you and to Stefan, because I know that it is very late in where you are. So for me, it's very important. I believe that everybody here appreciate and join me in supporting you because of sharing your time with us. And one more time, thank you. Unfortunately, you won't be with us in Cuba, but I hope that I can see you in Costa Rica in October.
Yeah. Thank you for inviting us. It was a real pleasure. And you know what is the problem with Sander and me? We could talk about these things for hours and hours and hours. But I think it's time. It's past 8 p.m. Here, so let's close down the discussion about IPv6, and I would be more than happy to repeat this stuff, and maybe we can go and set up a discussion generically on IPv6 and what issues people have, because this is very useful for me and for Sander to understand what the issues are and where to help.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having us here. Was a pleasure being here, and I think this is my first activity in LACNIC, so thanks.
You need to come to one LACNIC meeting.
I don't believe that. After this session, you will say, no, Alejandro Acosta again, he's writing me one more time an email.
All right. Thank you, Stefan. Okay.
So yeah, good night everybody, and my pleasure. Thank you.
Thanks everybody for joining.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Bye.
Gracias, adiós.